more than 40 cars in the field for the Fujitsu Series race here at Bathurst this afternoon. Our special guest commentator today for this one is a man who's come very close to winning the Bathurst 1000 in the past and is teaming with Greg Murphy this weekend, the great Cameron McConville, alongside the equally great, for other reasons, Greg Rust.
Thank you, Billy. And you're right about the number of entries, too. It's a record for the Fujitsu Development Series. And Cam, 42 cars. That's going to be busy.
A massive field, very busy. And that's why qualifying, as you can see here on the screen now, was very, very important. You need to start in that top 10.
Terrific performance by young Andrew Thompson driving for Dick Johnson Racing. And Nathan Pretty, one of the many drivers in this field who will be doubling up across the weekend. Shane Price and Jack Perkins, who are, of course, running the second car for Larry Perkins' outfit in the main race, the 1000. So they're doing double time this weekend, and that's all valuable miles for those young blokes.
Oh, it is, and you'd think that they will get quicker as this race weekend progresses. I think that's a pretty impressive qualifying effort for both of them. Nathan Pretty, probably the most experienced guy in this field around this track, so good effort for him to be on the front row.
Huge field here. Matthew Hunt, Chris Pither, who is probably not quite where... Now, his grid position, Cam, isn't necessarily reflective of his ability. We've seen a pretty reasonable run from him in the older spec AU Falcon throughout the year so far.
You'll see a lot of team owners watching this from the main game championship series, because this is where the next breed of co-drivers for the main game will come through next year. A lot of guys having their first run at the mountain, they get through cleanly on the weekend, it'll put himself in good stead for co-drives down the track.
Mark Howard suffered a broken Watts linkage after an accident at the cutting in practice. And lost some time there. He, of course, is teammate to the series leader, Adam Macro, the runaway series leader. This is a championship round. Two races here at Mount Panorama this weekend. We'll bring them both to you. And Macro, the first Development Series driver to win five rounds in a row. Achieved that at the last event at Malala in South Australia. The view from the WPS Flycam. Revs rising here. Ready to get underway with our coverage of the first race of the weekend. The mountain shakes. It comes alive in 2006. Nathan Pretty to the left of your screen. Good start by young Thompson. Andrew Thompson said to me just prior to this race, all he was concerned about was getting a good start for this one. He was really happy with his qualifying performance, Cam. He's been using Stephen Johnson, who is obviously a part of the Dick Johnson outfit, as his benchmark, measuring his sector times and looking at the way he performs relative to Stephen across the weekend. He did a terrific job in qualifying. Very strong, particularly across the top of the mountain.
It was a fantastic effort. Oh, we've got a crash. That's Chris Pine there out of turn one. And I think there's someone else going to... Oh, someone running wide there. I think that was Denya. But Nathan Pretty messed the start altogether. It was just very late with the jump. But you've got to hand it to Andrew Thompson. I think that's a very, very impressive effort to get the car on pole here.
Not sure whether Marcus Liddell has some sort of damage to the First Rock Home Loans AU Falcon. It did seem as though the bodywork was perhaps cutting into the tyre. Good work on coal tyres for Andrew Thompson. He's making the break here as we ride with Tony Evangelou aboard the Dexion Ford. He's been getting some assistance from Glenn Seaton this year. Glenn doing some driver coaching in this category and working with Tony. So fork is...
That's another impact with the wall there. I think that's just around over the tree before you get into Reed Park. The wiper going there. He's obviously tried to correct the car and hit the wiper stalk or something, but that looks like a reasonable impact with the wall there.
John Fork and Clayton Pine already. Okay, so safety car being dispatched. Let's have a look at the damage to the left front here of Clayton Pine's Commodore.
You can see the skid marks there, Rusty. I'd say that he may have been tagged from behind, because that's a long way out of the corner to actually leave the road.
Let's see if our replay here paints a clearer picture. That might have been with Gary Dean, I think. So they've had a bit of a elbows out scenario.
Well, he moved over and touched him early, and he realised that Gary Dean was there, so he then gave him some room, but then Dean's hit him again, and I mean, that's avoidable. You're in a straight line, first lap. You know, really, that crash was avoidable.
Well, drama here. And remember, this is a championship or point scoring round two. Now, here's Liddell's car. And look at the damage to that front left. That tyre's Gonski.
He needs to just really slow down. I mean, he's going to be out of the race at the back of the field, but he needs to get it back and do as minimal amount of damage, because that tyre flapping around can rip out the electricals and do more damage, so he just needs to cruise. And that's a shame. It's your first time at the mountain here, and he was doing a good job as well to be inside the top 15.
He's had a pretty interesting year so far, Marcus Liddell. Really showed some good speed in that older spec car. The subject of a huge crash at the opening round of the championship on the streets of Adelaide. The team worked really hard to get the car back in action. Now that's fork.
That was a big hit, so he was just not far out of the cutting around what we call the tree, and he's lost the back of that. It's hard to say from that angle whether he got a helping hand, but he's run straight ahead on the exit and clouded that wall. There'll be a lot of damage to that car.
One of the Kit Home entries, I'm not sure if it was Dean Neville maybe taking some evasive action there in one of the ex-Paul Cruikshank Falcons, an ex-Stone Brothers Falcon. Here's Liddell, who's in pit lane.
He was actually running wide out of that shot before Falk hit the wall, so I'm not sure whether he had some touch earlier at the start of that race and he could feel the tyre getting flat or what, but he has had some sort of touch, I'd say, in the first couple of corners.
1-2-1.
We've got Darryl Beattie and, of course, Mark Howard in pit lane, and no doubt we'll talk to the boys shortly. This might be our quick chance just to see how your weekend is progressing so far, Cam, at Super Cheap Auto.
We're reasonably happy, thanks, Rusty. We were sixth fastest in that session, Murph was. I was fifth fastest in the co-driver session. We're just trying to make the car a bit nicer to drive across the top of the mountain, but Murph will qualify the car, and I'm confident we'll be in the 10.
Let's go to pit lane. Mark Howard.
Greg, bad luck for Greg Smith. He didn't actually get to start the race. As they were preparing the car, the fire extinguisher went off in the vehicle. They tried to put a new one in, but they couldn't get a switch to match the master power situation. So bad luck for Greg to start the race.
No doubt we'll get an update on what's happening here as far as Marcus Liddell is concerned, and maybe an answer on whether he was involved in the incident with John Falk. So what an incredible start. And we have seen this in the past in the Development Series races here at the Mountain. You'll remember last year, from memory, half points were awarded because we had some incidents in the final race of the weekend, didn't we?
Well, this is race one. It's a 14-lapper. We're getting set for a 30-lapper tomorrow for these guys, and that's what it's all about. You need to just get through this race, get a good grid position for that final one, and so, a bit of a shame some cars taken out already.
Andrew Thompson is your race leader under safety car from Nathan Pretty. Tony D'Alberto in an excellent third position. Shane Price driving for Larry Perkins' team is fourth. Wayne Wakefield, good to have him back in the field. He's fifth. Mark Porter, who's on double-time duty this weekend, driving his Commodore in the Development Series and for Team BOC in the main game. We will take a break on the first day of our big 3 days of coverage of the Super Cheap Auto 1000. Back in a moment. Our coverage of the first race in round six of the Fujitsu Development Series continues at Mount Panorama Bathurst. And as you can see, we've gone green once again. Marcus Liddell has rejoined the circuit. The race is being led by a young Queenslander, Andrew Thompson from Nathan Pretty. And this is a bit of a breather here for Nathan, who didn't get the best of starts, Cameron McConville.
No, he was just slow away. It looked like he missed the jump or missed the light. Thompson got a great start. D'Alberto there in third, one of the Jack Daniels of Perkins cars there in fourth, but Adam Macro is actually back in P7, so this is an odd pick for him, having to actually pass cars, and he's got to be a little bit careful. The longer race is tomorrow, but he also wants to protect that championship lead.
We're on board now with the series leader, Adam Macro. Remember that this weekend last year he finished on another car around. That's Tony Evangelou, the Dexion Ford. It's an ex-FPR Falcon, and that's not a nice position for him to be in. Or how close was that?
That gives you a view of the driver. We just need a heart rate attached to that shot, because it's a completely blind corner. He's really done the best he can do there. He's now grabbing reverse because he really can't see around that corner. So a real shame for Evangelou, who had qualified reasonably well. Maybe he got a tap there. Now he's in real trouble. He'll have to do a three-point turn.
Because Marcus Liddell is still on the circuit, and I don't think he'd quite caught the tail of the field after rejoining from pit lane.
Still in trouble. I mean, it just shows how tight, and now I think he may have stalled the car.
He's having trouble
even
firing it up.
Doesn't want to start either. He's in trouble, so this could actually bring the safety car out too.
And this may block the circuit, as you quite rightly say, Cam. So Nathan Pretty's in gets in second position driving for the Smith's Trucks team. Now, although he's taking part in this development series race here, he's unlikely to be in qualifying this afternoon. He's driving with Paul Wheel in the second of the Super Cheap Commodores with your outfit. What's the scenario there? There was unfortunately a moment for Paul Wheel this morning.
Evangelou's getting out of the car, so this will, well, you'd have to say safety car, but Paul Wheel just had a bit of an off at turn one, just coming out of here that you can see now, got the curb and unfortunately tagged them all on the inside or on the outside of turn one, and a little bit of a kick in the chassis rail and a few broken components, so they won't be able to qualify today, unfortunately, in the number 50 car.
It did look from that shot. Okay, so there was some contact. David Clark and Tony Evangelou, Chris Alajarjan, Grant Denyer and a number of others managed to avoid it.
Yeah, really a bit late to try and execute a pass there. They're nearly at the apex. Probably wasn't far enough up there. David Clark and Evangelou's been turned around. So you can see he's heading into the apex. The contact is right there. So he was the innocent party in that one.
It did seem as though that the safety car may have either been dispatched or is on its way. So safety car has been dispatched. It's missed the leaders, obviously. So
all cars to slow down. The safety car will be overtaking them at the most appropriate spot, which would probably be after Forest Elbow.
Okay, so you can hear race control there, and they're advising what they're going to do because they weren't able to pick up that leading bunch, including Andrew Thompson and Nathan Pretty. So when they get to a situation, Cam, where they can obviously let these guys by and readdress, pick up the correct car, that will happen. View from race control. You can see Colin Bond there.
The driver's right. Once you see that, hopefully the field will have slowed to appropriate speed and you'll go past the leaders in Conrod Strait.
Well, there's a lot of cars to wave by because you can see Nathan Pretty there, Andrew Thompson. They're a long way back from the front of that sort of trail of cars, so they're going to have to wave a fair few vehicles through. It's unfortunate because it's just upsetting the flow of this race. They're just starting to get into a rhythm and another safety car.
This is an ex-FPR Falcon that Tony has acquired, as we mentioned, just prior to the break there. He's been working with Glenn Seaton during the season to get some driver coaching and advice, and Glenn's actually been to test sessions with him at Winston Motor Raceway and driven, you know, 40-odd laps in the car and helped him with the setup and, you know, just getting Tony, you know, heading in the right direction.
Well, his pace and qualifying pace in particular has been improving into a regular top 10 contender. It's a shame there. It's just odd for the car not to turn over like that. In qualifying, when you get weighed on the scales, you have to turn the car off and be able to restart it on its own power. So the alternator or something hasn't been charging. It's just drained that car. Maybe a bit of heat soak didn't help it, but I think he's trying to restart it again now. But
doesn't sound like it's going to happen. Yep. So Tony Evangelou, the Dexion Ford, going no further. We have the safety car out once again here at Mount Panorama. This is the Fujitsu Development Series. How hard is the job for the marshals who work tirelessly here at Bathurst trying to push that thing out of the way? Pretty difficult scenario.
Well, it's just so steep there too, Rusty. It's obviously just about rusting up on the wall. The TV doesn't do it justice. It's fairly cambered down in towards that wall there, and they obviously can't budge it. Although struggling, it's starting to turn over again, so I think he may need someone to actually tow him back from the inside of the wall there.
We'll take a break, and when we come back, we will no doubt go racing once again. This is our coverage of the Super Cheap Auto 1000 at Mount Panorama Bathurst. We're back at Mount Panorama as our coverage of round 6 of the Fujitsu Development Series continues. A replay of Chris Alajarjan and David Clark entering the final turn. Both former go-karters. And Cameron McConville, your thoughts there? Alajarjan perhaps anticipated being squeezed and rode the curb too much by the look of it.
Well, it was actually the curb that set it off. And here's another spinner, and this is actually Jeff Emery being touched by Evangelou. You'd see Alajarjan did a spin turn, didn't quite make it, and just decided to go into the pits in the background there. But yeah, hit the ripple strip quite aggressively, and that set the car off into a spin.
Now, we understand also, here's a big one, Mark McNally. After a top 10 finish at the last round of the championship in South Australia, he's the teammate to Tony D'Alberto, who's been running in the top 3. That's a big hit, Cam.
He lost it as he turned in on entry to what we call the tree there. He actually lost the back and then it overcorrected and came back on itself hard into the wall. That is a massive hit, and you will not see that car running again this weekend, I'd say, looking at that.
Spin I think that's Robert Jones there. So that's coming just off the exit of the chase. So, gee, we've had some incidents here. Andrew Thompson, the young Queenslander, leads the way from Tony D'Alberto. The surprising news is this right here. Nathan Pretty, after running in an excellent second position for the Smith's Truck squad, has got some sort of problem. The car slowed coming down Conrod Straight. He's managed to limp it back to pit lane, but his day is done, and he's Barry Tanton in pit lane two by the looks of things. So what a race, Cam, and this is a championship point scoring race for those that contest the development series. A lot of young guys that have come up through go-karting and the co-drivers of tomorrow, the stars of tomorrow. There's McNally out of the car. Good to see that he's okay after such a big hit.
Well, that is a big hit, Rusty. It would have been about 130-140 kilometre an hour impact with the wall at least, and it's a shame for Nathan's championship because Mark Porter was running very close to him in points overall, and he's going to score around 135 points out of this, and Nathan will, well, he's on 10 at the moment, but he'll probably end up with 0 points as a non-finisher.
Coming into this round, Adam Macro on 1504 points, plays young Shane Price on 1364, and both Shane and of course his teammate Jack Perkins have really been, you know, they've really starred in this series during 2006, considering that they don't have the experience like Adam Macro does in this series.
They've done a great job. I mean, Shane Price has been the standout as a rookie in the championship to be, you know, in the top three. He's actually running third at the moment and doing some very competitive lap times as well. As the tyres start to wear off, he's doing a great job.
Mark?
Nathan, when you were at the front of the field, what happened?
Look, it's very disappointing, running a nice solid second, and the Max Miss Trucks Holden Commodore just developed a miss coming through the elbow that last lap and just died.
You're running with Paul Wheel this afternoon, but further dramas there for you also.
Yeah, it hasn't been a real good Friday at all for us. Unfortunately, Paul had a mishap in the practice session and has done a bit of damage. The guys are working pretty hard to get it all ready, but I don't think we're going to qualify this afternoon, so I think we'll start from the rear bridge.
There you go, boys. They won't be qualifying this afternoon.
Tough day for that young guy there. And when he was partnered with Owen Kelly in the second Super Cheap Commodore last year, they did a terrific job. And, of course, Paul and Nathan were, you know, in good shape at the Sandown 500 this year, a top 10 result for those guys.
Well, you know, if you had a choice of co-drivers, if you're a regular driver in the championship, Nathan would be on top of the list. He's done a lot of miles around here and had a lot of top five results as well.
Replay of Robert Jones back in action. Unfortunately, he's already had a lose at the chase. And off again just at the final turn, which brings them onto the start-finish straight here. Murray's corner.
I think he just got out a little bit wide there. There's not a lot of grip on the outside that you can see. He actually lost it on turning very, very wide. I think Scott Loadsman was going up the inside of him. And it could even be another safety car there because it's very difficult to get out of that sand trap.
Now, what's going on here? Nice way to keep air conditioned. It's pretty warm at the mountain this year. Temperatures much higher than we've experienced in recent times, so it's not ideal, and no doubt the officials will be keeping an eye on Tim Monty, I think that was. So Andrew Thompson leads the way, his best lap a 2:11.74 from Tony D'Alberto. Shane Price is third. This will be good for Shane's championship when you consider that Adam Macro is fifth. We welcome back Wayne Wakefield to the series. He's been a bit of a wild child, the Queenslander. He's raced a rotary-powered Mazda station wagon over the years. He's been a regular in the development series and at one point drove as a co-driver for the Stone Brothers at Mount Panorama Bathurst here. Here's Macro chasing Wayne Wakefield.
Wakefield got very good power down.
Oh, big one, Mark Porter. Huge crash at the top of the mountain, and I think that's David Clark, possibly. Optimus Sport Falcon, we can't tell the car to the left of the screen. Let's hope. Goodness me, that's a big accident at the top of the mountain. That'll be game over for this race.
All cars could slow down as much as possible through the area.
Game over. Red flag. An incident-packed development series race here. The first of two that will bring you across the weekend. Mark Porter to the right of your screen, the Hydralink Commodore. He's a Kiwi. A former Trans Am racer.
They really need to get to those guys. There's no one at all going to those two cars. They really need to get to
the officials. Is that Chris Alajarjan's car, Cam? I think that's got some damage too.
Into pit lane for all cars.
And someone's hit some debris there. That might be Emery, I think.
Thank you, Yoss. Just confirming that instruction. All teams are to proceed directly to pit lane. All teams are
to proceed directly to pit lane.
Oh, we certainly hope that Mark Porter is A-OK. They need...
the medical car is actually there. That you can see just behind. I think it's going to David Clark first. If we can confirm that's David Clark. That's a very high-speed part of the track going into McPhillamy Park. And someone's lost the back of the car and spun. And I'd say Mark Porter's been T-boned. It's really hard to tell. But that is one of the biggest crashes you'll ever see.
Let's have a look here. So Porter's lost it at the top. Is it Shannon O'Brien or is it David Clark? Okay, Alajarjan, big lose. Oh, no. It is David Clark. Huge hit into the driver's side of Mark Porter's car, the Hydralink Commodore.
So I'd say Porter lost it on his own. I don't think he got a touch there. He's just tagged the wall. And at this point, he actually puts his hands up to his helmet. He knows he's vulnerable there. Alajarjan just clipped him. And Clark throws the outside option, nowhere to go.
The car that Porter is driving is actually Paul Wheel's old car from the Super Cheap squad, and Paul's done a fair bit of testing and spent a lot of time with him with that car during the year. Phil Curtis, a respected engineer from the V8 paddock here, works on that car across the weekend. There is massive damage to both cars.
The only thing I was going to say there is that fortunately, if there is any positive there, David Clark has actually washed off a lot of speed into the wall before he hit Porter.
Darrell?
Well, Greg and Cam, hopefully good news. I just spoke to the team here in pit lane and they just said they did get a few words from Mark. Obviously, reception at that part of the track, and Cam would know well, there are a few holes around here. Sometimes they can't get a constant conversation with him, but they did get initially a few words from Mark.
Well, that's good news. And the team of medicos and officials here are doing their best, as they always do, on this big weekend at Mount Panorama. Clark is a very successful championship-winning go-karter who's stepped up with the Optima Sport team this year, a relatively new outfit to the development series, and he's a driver that's shown huge potential in V8 supercars.
Even looks like the roll bar there was completely bent on that Porter car, so it's a big hit.
Red flagged, and this is how they finished. Andrew Thompson, great work. A victory for the young Queenslander. He'll be hugely happy with that from pole position. Tony D'Alberto second, Shane Price third. Remember that Shane is second in the championship at the moment. And Adam Macro finishes in sixth place. Michael Caruso, that might be a bone of contention there, depending upon when the red flag came out, whether Caruso managed to get past Macro, given the incident that's unfolded here. Matthew White finishes just outside the top 10. And Cameron McConville, we wish Greg Murphy and your crew all the very best for qualifying this afternoon. It's going to be a big day and the commencement of a huge weekend here at the Mountain.
Thanks very much, Rusty. We'll be trying as hard as we can, I can assure you.
There he is, Cam McConville. We'll take a break from Mount Panorama. There's lots more to come right after this.